had stomach cancer, was diagnosed as having stomach cancer. It was decided that Dr. Anthony should operate. And he told me, I still remember the names very clearly. He said the anesthetist was Dr. Umagilia. Some of the you doctors must have heard of Dr. Umagilia. And he said this Dr. Umagilia was a close relation of his mother. So the patient was taken in and Dr. Anthony opened up. Dr. Umagilia, the anesthetist who was the relation of this lady, took one look and said, sir, please close up. There is no point. Open. Sir, please close up. There is no point because apparently the cancer to all visible sight has spread. Then Mr. Jayasinghe told me that Dr. Umagilia told him that he just looked at him and said, doctor, you handle your side, I'm going to operate, not closing up. And he said for the next 4.5 hours, he cut and I don't know whatever surgeons do, cut and clamped and sutured and diverted and constructed, deconstructed and constructed. He said for 4.5 hours, he just went on. And finally, closed her up. Mr. Jayasinghe is a person of very few words. Then he uttered only one more sentence. He said, he gave my mother 5 years of life. That's all he said. I still remember this vividly. He gave my mother 5 years of life. Where, in the opinion of the anesthetist, again a very experienced doctor, said, sir, please close up. Now, that is what is meant. That's why I thought I'll take from your own profession to be. That you never give up. You never give up because certain things, you just do your best. One can't just judge everything. Napoleon, the great Napoleon, the general, emperor of France, he said that in war, 70%, now he had fought so many battles. He said in war, 70% is calculable. You can calculate and you can adjust where your armies are, where your artillery is. You can do all that. You can anticipate what the other side does. 30%, he says, you have to go blind and adjust to circumstances. In many things in life, it's the same. So you must never give up. These are not the only story I have heard. So-called impossible things become impossible because people didn't give up. Now that I'm addressing a medical crowd, let me give you a from the side of a physician. This time, I talked about a surgeon. These are real true examples. That's why they are important to you. These are not about not giving up. These are about what I said, that educated experience. Experience that if you are diligent about your work, that you yourself will acquire and become great doctors. Great physicians and surgeons, which you have the capacity to do. This story is about Dr. Cyril Pereira, the pediatrician. He worked in the private sector. They were good friends of ours and our family. And we had an only child. And we used to take this chap to see whenever he fell ill. We went to consult Dr. Cyril Perera. He had a consulting room in his house at Board Place. One day our son, who was about 10 years old, came from school with obvious symptoms of a cough and cold. And by next day he was developing fever. So I was a busy secretary to a ministry at that time. I was secretary to the Ministry of Food and Cooperatives. But I thought I'll take this person, my son. And my wife joined me and we took him to see Dr. Cyril Perera. He examined and it happened to be flu. So he gave some medicine and said, take a lot of kottamalli. Why? Because kottamalli is just because of an allopathic medicine. That's another matter. You don't become too fundamentalist and say only allopathic medicine or Western medicine works. He said, you take a lot of kottamalli in addition to this. That was done. Within 3-4 days, he was okay. Sent him back to school. 1 week later, he came home with the same symptoms. Now, I thought, what on earth is this? So, my first instinct was to give the same thing what Dr. Cyril Perera has prescribed. The kottamalli and the panadol if the fever goes up to 102 or something, the usual thing. But then I thought, after all, he is our only child. Never mind, however busy, no harm done, I'll have some mental peace if I take this fellow. So my wife also jumped into the car. And this was a very busy time. He normally sees patients at about 12:30 in the afternoon, and that's a very bad time for me. But anyway, I overcame all those mental blocks, so to speak, and took him. Now, Dr. Cyril Perera, he sits, there is a waiting room for patients and so on, with a lot of toys and colored picture books, like a pediatrician, is a pediatrician dealing with little children. Then he sits at a desk, and when the patient comes out, he has told not to close the door for some reason. So he is seated and he watches you walking. So the other patient came out, and my wife and I took this chap and we were walking. Now, Dr. Cyril Perera is a very genial, kind, nice, full of smiles and so on. But he was watching my son walking and he was knitting his brows. You could see there was no smile, he was just gazing at him and knitting his brows. And as we reached over the threshold and coming close to him, he said, Puta, come here, Puta, come, come. And just then he wanted to vomit. So there was an attached bathroom. My wife quickly took him and he was vomiting. And Dr. Cyril Perera, now he had not touched him. He had only observed him walking. This is interesting for you because you are going to be doctors. That's why I'm telling you this, even if it takes a little time. Because these are not in books. So I was a bit worried because this is not the normal look of Cyril Perera. I said, Cyril, what on earth? Why are you? I said, this fellow is like a magnet. He had got this flu again. That's what I told the Dr. Cyril Perera. I said, this fellow is like a magnet. He had gone to school and got this again. He said, no. This time I don't think it's flu. Now he had not laid one finger on him. Then I got dead scared. I said, what? What do you think? He said, no. This time I think it's pneumonia. this time I don't think it is flu. This time I think it is pneumonia. I was scared. But then very soon he came from the bathroom, wiping his face and so on. He said, Puta, come here, come here, come here. Put the stethoscope and said, yes, I looks like pneumonia, but there is an X-ray place down the road. Please go chest X-ray, lungs. Bring the wet plate and come. Went, got the X-ray, brought the wet plate, he put it on the thing with lights, that whatever you do that to see the X-ray. And there, he said, there, look, in the corner of one lung, there was a patch. And of course, I don't know whether it's a chloromycetin or whatever they gave. The pneumonia got knocked out faster than the flu because of a correct diagnosis and the correct drug. Now, what could have happened if I kept him at home and treated him for flu based on a week's experience of a week before? Now, why I told you this story is also that is what's called educated experience, just not a hunch. Sheer experience. He diagnosed the difference between on that occasion. And some others have told me some wonderful story which I don't have time to share with you. So those are the skills of doctors. And those are the skills that you must acquire. And finally, let me get to my third and last point. I have told you that you have to be alive mentally now, active mentally. Look at the significances of things. Don't take anything for granted. All this is happening because of a lot of other work done by others. We are very interdependent. We are not great people by ourselves. We depend even now on a whole network of people to sustain us. So first thing is critical, all the time, a critical view of things. Look at the significances of things. Don't take anything for granted. Starting from this procession today. Then I talked about free education, Mahapola, the value of that, and that we can't take for granted. Other countries are stunned. Then I told you about early in life. This is very important because you are at an early stage of your life. We are on the way out. You have to determine what is your bottom line. What is the line that you don't cross under any circumstances? That's not an easy task. Each one of you will have to determine that. Sometimes with the help of your parents, elders, others. But there is a line that you can't cross. And you have to each one work on it. Then I mentioned to you, talk to you about attitudes. That you never give up. That you don't find excuses. You just don't utter slogans and shut your mind. That is not worthy of university students. And I gave you some examples about what this really means in practice. My final, very hopefully brief point is for you to, this is all a thinking process for you. I'm not telling you anything. Aren't we disaggregated individuals? The ideal is to have an integrated personality. But are we, how many of us are integrated? Ekabadh. Not visiralagya. Now what do I mean by that? Just look. We function in compartments, don't we? Our learning is one compartment. Our exercise is another compartment. Our religions, practice of our religion and spiritual matters are another compartment. Our social relations are yet another compartment. Now, I just want you to think about it. That's all. I have no prescription. In any case, I'm not a doctor. I can't give you prescriptions. But is it necessary for this to be so? You young people must think. Take your profession, you are going to be doctors. Now you are going to, and you are to continue studying, keeping up. Now you are undergraduates, you are going to be doctors, you are undergraduate, you are studying. Now, have you got the time for exercise? You may not have time if you can think conventionally. Sampradayanukoola vahitu. But what is exercise? Exercise is not just going to a gym. Now, I am standing and talking, this is exercise. I read an article on exercise in a world-class magazine some time ago. And that magazine said, this is about losing calories and so on, like exercise. That article started by saying, if you are reading this while stretched in your bed, sit up. The very fact of sitting up and reading will be burned more calories than if you are sleeping and reading. Then he said, if you are sitting and reading, stand up and read it. You will burn still more calories. If you are standing up and reading it, read and walk about. Sakma. He said, you burn still more exercise. The whole article was about, for busy people, that you get your exercise on the run. They say if you are going by, he says, if you are going by bus, don't get down at the nearest bus halt to your home. Get down one or two bus halts away and walk. Automatically you get exercise, no special time. You don't wait for, I see young people waiting for a lift to climb one flight of stairs. I never wait. At my age, I am over 70, on a matter of principle, until I get crippled, I climb at least, I used to climb four flights, until my friend Dr. H.H.R. Samarasinghe scolded me and said, what are you trying to do to yourself? And when I told him that, you know, I go slowly and there are the landings and I just check myself to see that I'm not out of breath when I 87 steps at one stage. He said, no, I don't want all that talk. You climb one flight and that is all that can be permitted for a person of your age. So now, I must respect his opinion. He is a, who am I to question him? So I climbed one flight. But I climbed down 3 to 4 flights. And I find all the better by the time I come, because otherwise you are just going from seat to seat. So there are a lot of exercise that you can get on the run, including walking about and reading. That is exercise. And then you don't feel sluggish. There's the blood flow and you become energized. So there you can integrate your work and your exercise. Then what about your religion? Now, is religion about going to temple, church, mosque or kovil? Yes, partly yes. But what is religion after all? In simple terms, we say pinna. acting karma, merit. Christians say do good deeds. The Muslims have a concept called zakat. Zakat. That is, they have to, Muslims must give a certain portion of their wealth every year to the poor, which is dana, what we call dana. Same with Hinduism. Concept of dana, karma. Now, if you are a doctor, if you treat your patients with kindness, concern, with your mind accompanying those deeds for the welfare of those patients, you're automatically getting merit, ping. You don't have to go to temple to go get the merit. Actually, we who have been in the public service and you who will be large number in the public service in particular, not that the private sector won't have these opportunities, have enormous opportunities of acquiring a lot of merit. So like you exercise, you integrate your spirituality into your healing. You are not disaggregated, you are one individual, but you have aggregated all this. That is really my last point, that you would be well advised to think about not functioning in compartments, not in a disaggregated fashion, but in a holistic, aggregated fashion. Now, medicine, if you are going to be a good doctor, there are about three things that you have to be good at. They say that doctors must cure sometimes. Relieve often, cure sometimes, relieve often. Treat with compassion, be compassionate always. Three fundamental matters pertaining to your profession. You cure sometimes, because that's a practical thing. You can't cure all the time. With your best efforts, people die. So you cure sometimes. You relieve often. You relieve distress, you relieve pain. You prolong life. That you do often, you have to. That's part of your profession. And you remain compassionate. Exercise compassion always. Now that is where lot of us, not only doctors, fail. Very often we think we don't find the time to be compassionate because there are so many people. But you must try. Because particularly, it is very much part and parcel, if not any other profession, is part and parcel of the great profession. A profession which is called the noble profession. And if you want to maintain the nobility of that profession, the last thing, be compassionate at all times You have to find the time to cultivate. Thank you very much.